Well, good morning, Elmer Baptist Church, and welcome to worship. You may be worshiping with us online from on YouTube, or you might be worshiping through Eastlink at 4 p.m. on Channel 98 or 610. And you may be watching us from Elmer or Tillsonburg, St. Thomas, Copenhagen, Springfield, Port Bruce, or my own personal favorite, King's Mill Corners. Welcome to worship as we gather in God's presence. This is week 3 in our series entitled OMG, A Call to Prayer. And today's sermon explores the topic and the prayer of against injustice. And the sermon is entitled OMG, That's Not Cool. This is a momentous day for us as well, for this morning or this evening, as we gather to record this service, we actually have a congregation with us, meeting the guidelines of Southwestern Public Health. We are able to gather on this Thursday evening to pre-record the service that you are watching here this morning. And we hope that as we journey through this time of preparation in July, we will be ready in September for in-person services on Sunday morning. Now, you can find out more about this process that we're going through towards reopening by subscribing to ABC Connect. And if you're not subscribed to ABC Connect, go to our website, elmerbaptistchurch.ca, and you can subscribe from there. I believe those are all the announcements we have this morning. So let us come together and worship. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks that we are gathered in this space, that we are gathered in our home, and through the magic of technology, we are able to gather together, to pray together, to sing together, to worship together, to hear your word proclaimed together. Bless our time. Bring your presence to bear upon us that we might sense and be transformed by your presence on this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we begin this time of praise, we invite you to join in your hearts as we worship and sing, "You're Worthy of My Praise."
I will trust you. Well, good morning. I'm with the Reverend Dr. Gloria Garcia Rivera, and she is the interim director of Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America. And you are one of our partners, and so it's a real pleasure to be with you over Zoom today.
It's a real pleasure to be with you today and BPFNA, the Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America. It's an organization that has been a partner with you and walking with Canada and with your church for many, many years. So we are happy to have this time of conversation. And I hope and I pray that it will be a time of grace.
Well, thank you very much. And for those of you watching, if there's a little bit of interference on our Zoom, it's because Doris is coming to us from Puerto Rico. So it's going to be an interesting internet dialogue. Doris, tell me a little, you've been the interim director now since when?
Since 2019, I entered BPFNA as an interim director.
Okay, and can you tell us a little bit, for somebody like me who knows very little about BP, I'm terrible with acronyms, so I'm going to say the Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America. Can you tell us a little bit about that ministry that we've been a part of for over 20 years now?
It is an extraordinary ministry. The Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America is the largest Baptist network of peacemakers. And it is a compound of Canada, Mexico, United States, and Puerto Rico. So we have around 6,000 members and about 1,400 members that are supporting members of BPFNA. And what I really love most of this organization is the inclusiveness, the diversity that we have, and the commitment to support others. So that's the main goal of BPFNA. I have been blessed by being part of BPFNA, first as receiver of grants for projects when I was a missionary in Chiapas, Mexico. And now that I as an interim director, knowing the network, the people, the churches, the projects that the churches are doing for peace with justice, it's amazing. It's really a galaxy. It's a galaxy of peacemaking, ongoing effort all over.
Oh, that's wonderful. I know that us as a church, we've been involved in the past through peace camps. What are peace camps and what do they look like? Let's say post-pandemic. What would they look like post-pandemic?
Well, post-pandemic, 2020, we did our first virtual summer conference, and we gathered around 600 people from 10 different nations. And it was really good to see each other. And we did have some fellowship, but we long to be together, because Peace Camp has been one of the most important and the crucial events every year annually for BPFNA, where we gather and equip members. It's a unique space of fellowship, but due to the pandemic, we engaged in our first virtual conference, and we did well. We learned a lot, really a lot. And now we are almost to start our second virtual conference, and now in July 20th. I invite everyone to participate. This time will be workshops and panels to give you tools for peacemaking. So we kind of change a bit the focus of the conference to give workshops for tools for the members of the organization. And it's gonna be an extraordinary time, and we are really investing a lot in doing this with the partners that we have.
Well, thank you. Now, we are one of your Canadian partners. And what role does Canada play in this movement?
Well, Canada, as a member nation, the voice of Canada is very important. The way you word your ministry in the advocacy and defense of Indigenous groups, in the climate concerns, in the defense of other minority groups. And I mean, you can share, you share what you're doing. And that's part of being in the fellowship. We learn from each other. And your voice is very important. You be at the table of BPFNA is very important, because we, the making peace transcend geography, but it is key in the way we do ministry, in the way we believe we belong to the body of Christ. So Canada has a lot to teach us. In the United States, in Mexico, and Puerto Rico has a lot to share. And your witness is an extraordinary space for us as a fellowship to also mutually learn from each other. So we need Canada at the table, definitely.
Now, I understand us at Elmer Baptist Church, we have a member within our own congregation that is up for nomination for a position on the board. And that would be Karen Hilliker. And so we are praying that, Lord willing, at the assembly, you'll be able to, she'll be able to add her Canadian voice to the board.
I think when we engage, and when that is one of the things that people cherish most, being at BPFNA, especially at the camps, when people get together and share their stories and share their ministries, what they're doing. It's a cross-feeding, but it's a cross-nurturing of the kingdom of God, of getting new ideas and fresh ideas of doing ministry. So I think that having a Canadian voice at BPFNA board, but also as partners, gives the Baptist Peace Fellowship a more inclusive, but also an international understanding besides the United States, because Mexico and Puerto Rico are more Central American and Caribbean, more Latino, Hispanic-oriented vision. And from the United States and Canada, we have that more Western vision of the people who are engaged in peacemaking. So we really need Canada with us.
Well, that's what I'm so glad I've had this opportunity to speak with you, Doris, and I look forward to other opportunities in the future to work closely with Baptist Peace Fellowship in North America. Thank you. God bless you. And until we meet face to face.
Amen. God bless you all.
Bye-bye.
I'm just hiding away on my front porch right now, just trying to get a little bit of peace and quiet. A place where I can be alone for a little bit. Do you ever do that? Look for a place where you can just be alone with nobody bothering you? A quiet place where you can just think? You know, Jesus did that as well. In the Bible, we read that often Jesus would get up early in the morning before anybody else got up, and he would go to what the Bible calls a solitary place, a place where he could be alone. And there he would pray. He would talk to God. He would share with God his life and his worries and his joys. Just a time to be alone with God. And often the disciples would get up in the morning and they'd have to go look for him because he had been there for quite a while. I love these times when I can just be by myself and think and share my ideas and my thoughts with God. Just rest for a little while. And I hope you can do that too. I hope sometime today and throughout the week you have a chance to kind of sneak away and be alone. so you can share your thoughts with God and just rest for a while. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for these moments where we can hide away and be with you, talk to you, and get to know you better, feel at home with you. Oh God, we know that no matter where we hide, you can find us, and we can find you. Thank you for these wonderful times of prayer. Amen. Bye for now.
Well, that was a wonderful interview, wasn't it, with the Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America. It was wonderful to be able to speak with Doris. And as you might have noticed at the very beginning of the interview, I called her Gloria, and that was my bad. Luckily, I was able to correct that during the rest of the interview. But the Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America is focused on issues of justice. And it is fitting that that interview came today as we focus on the topic of justice and prayers against injustice. And so I'd like us during this time of prayer to lift up those injustices that come to mind, and I will give you an opportunity at the end to, in silence, offer some of your own prayers, and then we will end with Tanzi leading us through a sung version of the Lord's Prayer. Well, let's come together. Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, we come into your midst mindful that you have given your Son, Jesus Christ, that we might be redeemed, that we might enter into an eternal relationship with you. And yet, Lord, we find ourselves in a world overwhelmed with injustice. All is not right with the world, and we pray to you to make things right once again. During this season, we are mindful of our Indigenous brothers and sisters who have suffered great injustice through history, often at our own doing, at the bequest of the church. We pray, O God, that their voices might be heard now, that reconciliation might in fact take place, that there might be a restoration of trust, or maybe even the beginning of a relationship of trust once again. We pray against the injustice inflicted on children now grown, and children who did not live to see this day. We pray, O God, and lift up to you the injustice that we find within our social structures and political structures to this day. Structures that were shaped at a time where it made sense, and now it doesn't. The implications of those decisions have resulted in racism that needs to be dealt with in our country and in other countries as well, O God. Open our eyes that we might see and work through the systems that disenfranchise many, that make some less significant than others. Systems that were created to keep people out. We pray that we might have the courage and the wisdom to work together to dismantle structures that are now unjust. We see injustice, O God, within our own church and the wider church. Many of the wrong choices that were made through history were made with the church's consent. And we confess that. We pray, O God, that we, the body of Christ, might become a place where people are treated with fairness and equity, where your justice reigns. May we be your instruments of justice, O God. O Lord, hear now our prayers for justice, which we offer now in silence.
Our first scripture reading is taken from Psalm 12, verses 1 to 8, and it's written responsively, so I invite you to join in on the sections that are marked all, and then I will end with a prayer at the end. Help, O Lord, for there is no longer anyone who is godly. The faithful have disappeared from humankind. They utter lies to each other. With flattering lips and a double heart, they speak.
May the Lord cut off all flattering lips, the tongue that makes great boasts, those who say, with our tongues we will prevail. Our lips are our own. Who is our master?
Because the poor are despoiled, because the needy groan, I will now rise up, says the Lord. I will place them in the safety for which they long.
The promises of the Lord are promises that are pure, silver refined in a furnace on the ground, purified seven times.
You, O Lord, protect us.
You will guard us from his generation forever.
On every side, the wicked prowl, as vileness is exalted among humankind. O God of justice and truth, chaos often clouds the day and fears command the night. Remind us always of your promise to guard and protect your people, and of your perfect holy love revealed to us in Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Our gospel reading is Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 to 15. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others for their sins, your Father will not forgive you for your sins.
We're getting used to our new way of normal again. So we're getting there slowly but surely. Oh, that's sounding better. So far we've looked at the prayer of contentment, the OMG, I'm good. And then last week we looked at the prayer of confession, OMG, my bad. And this week we're looking at the prayer against injustice, or OMG, that's not cool. Now, if you're new to the scene, you'll know that OMG means, oh my God. And what better prayer is there than, oh my God? It speaks of the passion with which we approach God. And there are times in our conversation with God that we simply want to cry out against the injustices that we see. You look around the world, and you look around your neighborhoods, and you realize that all things are not right with the world. To use David's words in Psalm 12, help, Lord, for no one is faithful anymore. Those who are loyal have vanished from the human race. Everyone lies to their neighbor. They flatter with their lips, but harbor deception in their hearts. And then you also have Jesus in the Lord's Prayer declaring that our Father, all is not right with the world. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Yes, indeed, all is not right with the world, and there is a whole lot of stuff that's just not cool. We have a long way to go before God's will is done on earth as it should be done, it has been done in heaven. Lying lips still prevail. They've reached a point where they rise up to the highest levels of leadership. The rich become obscenely rich, while the poor become more impoverished by the second. Evil and violence and deception is celebrated as wisdom, while the marginalized are dehumanized and the other matters less than the self. The great commandment, love your neighbor as yourself has become love yourself first. Keep only the friends that will benefit you and cast off the rest, for they will only bring you down. Hateful propaganda, tax evasion, destruction of property are all lifted up as responses to injustice. You see an injustice, you vandalize. You see an injustice, you cheat the government. You see an injustice, you respond with lies and gossip. Hatred of the other prevails, while reconciliation and diplomacy now don't even get an opportunity to come to the table and be seated. And that's be seated in the farmer sense, not in the sit down sense. The pursuit of one's individual rights are now uplifted as cries for personalized justice, while advocacy for the oppressed and the marginalized is denigrated, ridiculed, condemned, and rejected. So yes, indeed, all is not right with the world, and that's not cool. Oh my God, may your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Eugene Peterson's paraphrase in the Message translates this portion of the Lord's Prayer as, O God, set the world right. Do what is best, as above, so below. Robert Young in 1898 wrote a literal translation of the Bible in an effort to be as literal as possible. And he translates this part as, Thy reign come, thy will come to pass, as in heaven, so on the earth. Notice the use of the phrase, thy reign come, instead of thy kingdom come. You'll find this as well in the French version of the Lord's Prayer. Que ton règne vienne, that your reign might come. For you see, thy kingdom come is not so much about earthly kingdom building or the church being in control of the earth's social structures and political structures, but rather it is envisioning that day when God will reign on earth, when all will be right with the world, when justice and righteousness will prevail. Well, whenever you want to talk about justice, you have to talk about righteousness. And in fact, in the Bible, the word justice and righteous are often used synonymously, interchangeably. But I do think there is a difference between the two, especially as we understand them today. Justice is about advocacy for the other. Justice is the message that came from the prophets. Like in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, that proclamation of good news to the poor, freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, and the setting of the oppressed free. The stuff of advocacy for the sake of the widow and the orphan, the poor and the stranger and the refugee, the oppressed and the marginalized, the voiceless and the lost. That's the stuff of justice. As for righteousness, righteousness is about what is right, what is pure, what is pious. It's the stuff of obedience and right living. Unfortunately, righteousness can often deteriorate in its understanding into legalism. In an effort to narrowly define what is right and what is pure and what is pious and what is appropriate for God's kingdom. And from there, things can deteriorate even further to the point where righteousness becomes about the rights of the righteous, the rights of the believer, which we then redefine as a righteous battle against injustice. And that injustice is against us. We as evangelicals probably began to lose our way on this issue of justice around 1970. Before that, during the civil rights movement in the 50s and the 60s, we saw Christians, we saw Canadians and Americans, we saw Americans both north and south, black and white, rallying together. Even non-Christians gathered and rallied with Christians for the sake of justice, for the sake of the other, the racially marginalized, the refugee, the poor, the vulnerable, all that widow and orphan stuff. It was a ministry of advocacy, not unlike the advocacy we saw with BPFNA, Baptist Peace Fellowship of North America. But in the 1970s, there came a Reverend Jerry Farwell and others, and the religious or Christian right or moral majority, the pro-life movement and the focus on the family movement. And suddenly, bringing about the kingdom of heaven on earth was no longer about justice and advocacy for the other. It was about the preservation of Christian rights for ourselves. Advocacy was replaced with self-advocacy and self-promotion and defense of one's rights. The OMG, that's not cool prayer against injustice became focused on what was right and pure rather than what was justice and advocacy for the oppressed and for the lost. It became a prayer about pointing out fault in others rather than seeking justice. It became about reclaiming a Christian nation rather than modeling a just society in Christ's name. And now we have reached an era where thoughts and prayers are words that flow from the lips of politicians and Christian rights advocates without ever addressing the issue of injustice. In fact, thoughts and prayers are often offered as a strategic tactic for diffusing crises and diverting justice. But the sad part of all of that is that thoughts and prayers are among the greatest responses we can have as believers in the face of injustice, when they are offered humbly before God. You see, did you notice that in Psalm 12 and in the Lord's Prayer, our earnest prayer is for God to act for the sake of justice? Help, Lord, for no one is faithful. Help. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We offer our thoughts, our deep reflection. We invest intellectual energy into the crises of injustice. And we earnestly pray to God to act and to use us as his hands and his feet and his mouthpiece. But it's not our job to fix it. It's not our job to vanquish injustice. It's God's job. And when we forget that, we become one citizen like any other. No more powerful, no more motivated, no more gifted, because God is not the center of the justice we seek anymore. We as believers pursue justice not as righteous citizens, but rather as humble followers of Jesus Christ, responding to God's call. As we are commended in Micah 6, verse 8, we are to act justly. We are to love mercy and to walk humbly with our God. And yes, we have a role to play in responding to injustice. But we must never forget that it is God that brings justice, not us. And if our understanding and our pursuit of justice is not rooted in God, then it's just our own agendas trying to be fulfilled as a way of living life rather than a way of serving God. But we do have a role to play. And I would offer you three things that Jesus gives us as tasks in fulfilling our call to do justice in the Lord's Prayer. We've noticed that God does not call us, and Jesus does not call us to be the agents of justice, but to allow God to do the justice through us. And the way that is done is in three ways. Number one, confession. Number two, modeling forgiveness. And number three, not getting in the way. Forgive us our debts. Forgive us our sins. Forgive us our trespasses, depending on the translation. As we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. There's a whole lot of talk about systemic racism at the moment and white privilege. It harkens back to a dark period in our history as institutions were being established and built at a time where women were not persons. The LGB community was being criminalized. Blacks were owned. The indigenous community and their children were stripped of their identity and their humanity and their land and their sense of being, all to preserve an establishment we had created. And while our views have changed, the establishments are still built the same way. We must acknowledge this. And we must confess our continuing role in supporting structures that remain unjust. And we must confess our personal role when we act in ways that are unjust, as We ask that our debts be forgiven, that our trespasses be forgiven, and that our sins be forgiven. That's the first step towards justice. If we are to be agents of God's justice, is to recognize our role in it. We must also model what forgiveness looks like when we ourselves have been treated unjustly. That's a hard one. In fact, the Lord's Prayer seems to indicate and tell us that the redempting, healing experience of being forgiven by God is directly related to our modeling forgiveness against those who have wronged us. If we cannot model forgiveness for others when we have been victimized, when we have been oppressed, when we have been dealt with unjustly, then we can't move forward. Efforts that focus justice, efforts to pursue justice that only focuses on the need for others to confess their sins and their injustices against us, while refusing to forgive the injustice inflicted on us by others, is doomed to failure from the start. As hard as this may be to hear, it is the afflicted who are called to forgive, regardless of whether the offender is willing to confess. Why? Because it's not about the offender. This is a covenant you have, I have, with God. God has forgiven us. We are reciprocating by forgiving others. And finally, we must unceasingly pray that we not get in the way of God's work of justice. Oh, how we can devise wonderful plans on how to fix the world and make it all right, only to discover that God had far better plans and we just got in the way. Let us not be part of the problem. Let us not be deceived by the evil one. Let us not venture on to crusades that God has not called us to. Let us not get sucked into the media because it seeks to suck us into debates that are not ours to have. As the Lord has taught us to pray, lead us not into temptation and into trials, but deliver us from the evil one. Let us bow our heads. Oh my God, help me to get out of the way. Let me not fall prey to the seductions of the evil one. Let me not become an agent of injustice myself. Let me not act unjustly in the pursuit of justice. Let my thoughts and prayers flow from your vision of justice, that your will might be done on earth as in heaven. And then, O God, let me act justly, mercifully and humbly, as your hands and feet and mouthpiece, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We pray for the lonely ones. We pray for the heartbroken ones. Join us in continuing our prayer for justice in the world.
Justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God, and you will fulfill God's calling on your life in the pursuit of justice. Amen.